Great. So thank you to my audiences. I'm your host, Amit Chaturvedi from IDP. I'm Associate Director for Client Relations for UK, New Zealand, and Ireland, looking after the South Asia region for IDP Education. And today I have brought in a very, very special guest with me who will give you some great insights on the prospects of one studying in UK, the challenges which students are possibly have come across, and how institutions and the university sector have helped these students to overcome those challenges, and a whole lot of the policies which government of UK has floated around the COVID times, how students have benefited, how institutions are coping with those changes and challenges. We'll get to hear a lot of insight from my guest, who is Richard Follett, Deputy Pro Vice Chancellor and the Associate Vice President at the University of Sussex for the International Work. What I'll do, I'll briefly introduce Richard before we start this conversation. And of course, as I've been sharing, talking about this conversation in my previous talks also, this is going to be a very, very insightful conversation with Richard. So as I said, he is looking after the work at the University of Sussex on the internationalization piece and the Deputy Pro Vice Chancellor of the university. He is responsible for developing, coordinating, and driving the university's internationalization strategy and provides leadership to Sussex international activities worldwide. He is also a professor of American history and a specialist on the history of slavery and emancipation in the United States and Caribbean. Prior to joining Sussex, Richard taught at the National University of Ireland, Galway. He completed his PhD at Louisiana State University on a Fulbright scholarship and has held visiting appointments at the University of Lagos, Nigeria, Nanjing and Beijing universities in China, and at the Heidelberg University in Germany. With more than a decade of senior university leadership in the field of international education, Richard is chair of university's UK International Africa Network and serves on the International Steering Committee of the Association of Commonwealth Universities, Higher Education and Sustainable Development Goals Network. So Richard, as I said, man wearing multiple hats, and I'm sure he is going to give us some great insight. Welcome to this show, Richard. Thank you very much for joining us this afternoon in India.
A good afternoon, everybody in India, and thank you so much for the generous introduction, Amit. And let me begin by saying happy Holi to everybody. I do trust you have had wonderful celebrations, even in this most difficult of times.
Thank you. Okay, so let's get on to this conversation. And I know there are a lot of people who would like to get some insight from you. And as we all understand, you are in an unlocked situation in UK. So give us some insight as we speak towards the end of March. What's the current situation and how does it look like?
Thanks very much. And I think to begin with, we have to start with a note of optimism, careful optimism, but optimism. As of yesterday, more than 30 million adults in the United Kingdom have received the first dose of the vaccine, either the BioNTech Pfizer vaccine or the AstraZeneca Oxford vaccine. That means that the vaccine program has already covered more than half of the total UK population, but everybody in the at-risk groups, that was to say over 50 years old, myself included, have been vaccinated. And what's important to note is that second phase of vaccination, the second vaccine jab, is being rolled out and it will be increased. The plans at the moment in terms of the United Kingdom is that all adults over 18 years old will have received their first vaccination jab by middle to late July. Now, at the very same time, the government is committed to making sure that everybody over the age of 50 will have received their second vaccine dose within 12 weeks. So on one level, on the vaccine front, it's very, very optimistic. In fact, as I'm sure you're aware, Amit, only as of right now, only Israel has a higher percentage of its population has been vaccinated than the UK. So it goes Israel, the United States, the United Kingdom, then the United States. And then regrettably, we go into much smaller numbers in other parts of the world, including our European neighbors. So one thing is very positive is the vaccine rollout is occurring very quickly. There's an awful lot because the UK has purchased a lot of vaccine doses so that it has the ability to vaccinate its population. And it's already talking about vaccine doses in September and October for those age 75 and plus, so that the caseloads of COVID-19 collapse. So vaccine is very positive. On a second point, the government has implemented a roadmap for releasing the economy and releasing our private lives. So at the moment, as you can see, I'm working from home in Brighton, England. That won't last for more, however, than another 2 weeks. And by the middle of April, we'll be able to begin to return to work. Now, lots of people will no doubt be doing hybrid work going forward, but the roadmap is very clear. And only yesterday, we were released into the next phase of the unlocking of the lockdown. So from yesterday, six people can meet in public spaces, and that will accelerate. So by the middle of April, for example, the gyms will reopen, all the stores will reopen, schools are already back, universities are expecting to go back. We'll no doubt talk about that a bit more going into the next few questions. But the roadmap to unlocking the UK is very, very, very optimistic right now. The government is choosing to keep restrictions on borders for the moment because they're trying to stop virus variants from entering the UK. That, I imagine, will in time also become eased as commercial traffic and indeed vacation traffic increases. There is no restrictions, however, for incoming international students, whether they're coming to join us this spring in advance of the June 21 deadline for the graduate route. There is no restrictions on them incoming to the UK, although they may have to quarantine. And we are expecting no restrictions on international students coming in. There may be quarantine restrictions, but there's no formal restrictions on students coming in September for the beginning of the academic year. So I think, honestly, from where we were back in January, when things were quite difficult in the UK, the picture as we go forward is one of cautious optimism. Amit, cautious optimism with a good plan for the future.
No doubt. I think what you have said is really reassuring for the students, where, you know, half the population is at that first stage of doses. And I'm sure by the time the younger lot of people who are aspiring to get to UK from around the world, they get into UK, I think it will be a far safer place to be in. By the way, just to add, in India, we have gone past 60 million first doses already given, but unfortunately that's less than 5% of the population. So that's some bit of irony at the moment. But interesting, I think you have made a very interesting comment. Now, looking at what you said, and with this kind of an optimism in mind, what is that the sector, the education sector, the higher education sector is doing to ensure, in addition, to have these students come when they either avail the GIR or when they come for the autumn of 21 intakes? So what is that the institutions are geared for in terms of support, in terms of other aspects to ensure that this journey, this experience now is really of that world-class experience which UK is known for?
Absolutely. And as we are in almost like forward planning mode, Amit, right now, in terms of what does it look like in September? What will students experience when they arrive at the campus of the University of Sussex or any of my colleagues' campuses across the UK? At Sussex, we're expecting to teach, and we're expecting to deliver in-person instruction. That is the position that we are in right now. We are not expecting to put lectures online. We know all the laboratories online or our seminars or any of our teaching. Now that, of course, provides us with an opportunity to flex. If situation gets more challenging, we could put the lectures on into a blended mode. But at the moment, we're not expecting to do that. We want the students who come to gain the full educational experience. If there is social distancing that's required of us, then our teaching teams will have to plan that. But what we're hoping for is a physical educational experience. But as we know through the pandemic, we need to also be ready to adapt flexibly. It is not impossible that the situation might deteriorate in terms of new variants. After all, if we went back to September or October last year in the UK, we had no real sense that there was a new variant, in fact, a British variant spreading quickly in the population. And we had to adapt then. We had to adapt over last summer. So I think what we're going to be clear amongst our students is, one, where we can deliver physically and it is safe to do so and it is compliant with the regulations, we will do that. At the same time, if we have to mix to a blended approach, then we will do so. But what is also important to say, Amit, is that at Sussex and most of my UK universities, teaching has been occurring all this year. Not just the online teaching, which we are all familiar with, but physically teaching. So our education faculty, for example, has been delivering in-person teaching. Our medical school's been delivering in-person teaching. Our media practice degrees have been delivering in person, our drama degrees. Many of our science degrees have included face-to-face practical experiments. And we are waiting for the government on April the 11th for an announcement over the regulations for opening up the universities to students to come back in April and May onto the campus. Now, honestly, that's most important for master's degree students than undergraduates, because much of the teaching year has already formally occurred. But we are keen to have guidance from the government on that. During the last year, when we have been open, of course, the University of Sussex has followed strict social distancing, the cleaning regime, which is common to all universities, the test and tracing, which I can speak to. We've had COVID testing on campus. But I think one of the most telling things is that we implemented our own test and trace system for students on our campus. And in fact, it was so successful that the government wanted to know about how we'd introduced this. Because before students had gone off and got a formal full-scale PCR test, we've been testing the students and tracing their contacts before they'd ever reached the National Health Service's tracing system. It was extremely successful. And it is one of the reasons why at the University of Sussex, our caseload of COVID cases was incredibly small. We were very lucky, very fortunate. We planned well, and we really were able to keep a control over COVID at the University of Sussex. I have to say, many UK universities, unfortunately, COVID exploded exponentially in the autumn months, we were fortunate we kept a control on it. So my statements to our applicants, and I hope you continue being enthusiastic about your study opportunities in the UK, wherever that might be. But I think the key message here is UK universities are expecting to teach physically. They might have to produce some online content, but probably for the course materials where you're in a big lecture theatre with hundreds of other people. But our expectation is to move forward. We will flexibly adapt if we have to. But the experience that you all want of coming abroad for a degree, and I was like you, I undertook most of my undergraduate and postgraduate degrees abroad. I travel all the time, usually every 3 weeks for the university before the pandemic. So I know what you're expecting, and it's a fantastic thing that you're all looking forward to. But I hope very much, I can't guarantee, because nobody can guarantee you at this point, but I hope very much that UK universities will be ready for university students in September to experience an education and social experience as they have in the past. Face masks might still be required. Social distancing might still be required.
Well, I think you have made a very valid point. It is reassuring to students that UK is gearing for this face-to-face experience. Students can look forward to some kind of a social life as they arrive into UK. So I think most of the students, when they look forward to choosing to study abroad, of course, education and experience and the social life and of course some other opportunities do come in everyone's mind that could be a reason for them to possibly choose to study abroad. But something which, you know, I was looking at some of the HESA data which came out recently, Richard, and of course the trends look like that even given that the last year was a pandemic year and all that situation, but we have seen an increase of students coming into UK. So what is your take? How do you look at the autumn 21 intakes? Because I think I know that's going to be one of the biggest intakes now in coming near future. So what would be your understanding and what assurance? Of course, you have said a lot about people, students who are aspiring to get to UK. What optimism they can have in mind when they arrive into UK. But where do you see interest for the destination lying at the moment?
Yeah, I think, I mean, the data, the HESA data really reaffirms something we're seeing both from IDP and from other organizations we work with, which is there has been, of course, a step change in interest in the UK, in India. It's not just in India that growth has, we've seen that growth. We've seen it in other parts of the world as well. And it's clear that the reintroduction of post-study work, the graduate route, has been instrumental in that respect. So I think that the post-study opportunities, 2 years, of course, for the PG taught or undergraduate, 3 years if you're doing a research degree, that opportunity to study without the requirement that it is that you have a job prior to the beginning of the post-study work placement is highly attractive. And that provides a moment in which students can not just reflect on their studies, seek opportunities, professionally develop their credentials in the employment space going forward. And I think to that end, going to universities which prioritize employability skills is going to be critically important wherever you're going to be going back to, whether that is spending 2 years in the UK before returning to Delhi, Mumbai, Hyderabad, or wherever it is that you're coming from. And I think one of the key messages, and I was involved in a very senior delegation of UK leaders to India just before the pandemic, and we released the report from Universities UK International on graduate employability of Indians. And that report really underscored the phenomenal lift, career lift, the graduates from UK universities who return to India secure, not just in base salary. So that the survey was taken over 5 years from the point of graduation to 5 years post-graduation. So not only were our graduates in India seeing a substantial increase on income, but they were involved by over 50% in management roles. Their leadership capacities were being developed. They were expressing advanced business connections that they'd been able to cultivate. Why? Not because they'd gone to a university, but because of the skills that they'd accumulated at the university. And to me, that's really the take-home message. And I work a lot in India, as you know, Amit, with partners across India on fourth generation industrial skills, wayfinding skills. And that's very clear in the national education policy, the refresh of the NEP in India. Very clear driver on graduate employability. What are the skills that employers need in India? Not now, but now and into the future. And how do universities fit to that agenda? So to my mind, there's a really powerful explanation as to why students have increased in application numbers through IDP and elsewhere. It's about the graduate route. It's about the fact that it's an uncapped graduate route. There's not a limited number of people. You do not need a job in advance. There's no minimum salary. It's work. You can be flexible. You can switch jobs and all of that in the 2 years or 3 years that you have. But it's because the experience of a British degree and added to that 2 years post-study will advance your skills and employability and income earning capacity that has to be to the advantage of the Indian economy and Indian society moving forward. So I think that's part of the explanation, as Amit, as to why students, not just in India, but they're also coming in increasing numbers in sub-Saharan Africa. Other parts of South Asia are seeing similar upticks in applicant numbers. And I think it's about the fundamentally, it's the world-class quality of the degree. It's about the graduate skills that are coming through the degree. It's about the graduate route that enables the post-study work. And it's about what, if you like, value for money means to the graduate. So they are really seeing an advance, career advance. And that matters to me. I mean, it matters hugely that our graduates are successful.
No doubt. I think it is always about the value proposition for the students. And I think we missed an opportunity around in January when we were expecting the Prime Minister Boris Johnson to come to India. And I was very hopeful that the new Indian education policy, plus the kind of thrust we see around UK's education system, we may see some positive announcements for this sector as well. But given that 2030, UK has announced a new education policy, looking at certain kind of volumes, yep. What's your take and what insight would you give to students on the policy and the, and if I can club the possible impact of Brexit on this policy and the international students' arrivals? So what would you be your take and your advice?
I think the as you rightly said, Amit, we had 2 months ago, the refresh of the international education strategy. That's the government's international education strategy, written with the universities. And in it, it has priority countries for UK engagement. And that those include India, Vietnam, Indonesia, Nigeria, and Saudi Arabia. And India is very much at the very top of those priority areas. So I would expect you to see not only the visits of people like Boris Johnson, but university delegations, including people like me, going forward. But I would expect to see a joined up UK government working with the Indian government to develop educational opportunities. And that's a clear priority. I've been working with the Association of Indian Universities and the Universities UK on credit mapping, making sure that the degrees that you get in the UK are recognized back in India. And that's vital work to ensure that that a piece of accreditation work is done. There are other kinds of work that are ongoing to make sure that we recognize that what is the credit balance on a degree. These might appear as small administrative matters, but they're really not, in fact. They are massive issues for your students and the people on this call to ensure that the UK education is already visible, recognizable within an Indian context. So I expect to see a lot more system-to-system collaboration that's already ongoing between the UK and India. I expect to see work by the Department of International Trade to support with the Indian counterparts. Sustainable, respectful partnerships in higher education. I have those. My partners are the Tata Institute of Social Science in Mumbai, with whom I have a very, very productive relationship, and also with parts of the University of Delhi, with whom I have also built very sustainable, very, very respectful models of international collaboration that must benefit, that must fundamentally benefit our Indian partners, number one. That's crucial to me. So I expect the IES, or the International Education Strategy, to deliver for India, but I also see it as a perfect moment, Amit, because IES, International Education Strategy, is our refresh, but you've got the NEP in India. And I've been watching and working on NEP issues for a while. There is almost a sweet spot moment now for UK-Indian collaboration. And I really, 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 like you, Amit, hope that we don't lose this opportunity to develop transnational education, to develop much more student mobility, not just students going to the UK, but British students going to India. And I had a whole program of 100 students who were due to go to Mumbai from my university last summer, sadly messed up because of COVID. But you get a sense from my side, at least, that I want this to be a two-way street of students going in both directions and learning both of our cultures and both of our systems. So I see great opportunities, actually, for UK-Indian relations. What does it mean for the students and the applicants on the call? The government has committed to doing a lot more work to ease the process of application. So easing the process from the point that you're interested and you come to Amit or one of the IDP offices across India and you begin that initial conversation. I'm interested in going to Cardiff. I'm interested in going to Sussex or Lancaster. All of those conversations that begin at that point. But from that stage, UK government is committed to ironing out as many of the wrinkles administratively, and moreover, putting pressure on UK universities again to prioritize graduate international employability. So I see the opportunities for Indian students as a win-win here. Brexit has changed the landscape. I'm a diehard European. I'm a diehard internationalist, as you know, Amit, from many, many, many conversations over the years. Leaving the European Union was personally very regrettable for me as an individual. But the agenda of global Britain that Boris Johnson is using does provide an opportunity to think about relationships in a different way. Than we have. For perhaps too long, because of being a member of the EU, some of our work had to be European-centric. But this is an opportunity now to think differently. And no mistake, last year, I wanted to bring 100 students to India on student exchange. Now I'm not a member of the Erasmus program. I'm going to have to be part of the Turing program. And as part of the Turing program, some of our students, quite a number of our students, will be coming to India to some of your finest universities to learn from Indian professors, to learn alongside Indian students And that is the nature of international education. It's a two-way street.
No doubt. I think we will see, and I think your vision is very interesting in that manner, where we see a exchange of students happening, not just traffic going one way. Maybe I'm sure you must be aware, but in the new policy, we are also looking at introducing one-year masters in India as well. And I'm sure when we talk of looking at equivalences with the international degrees, especially from UK, I think that could possibly be a point where we see a huge amount of acceptability coming into UK system and those aspiring at the moment to go to UK, where they find a lot of acceptability. Now, something which is, again, we have been receiving these questions from a lot of students. We talked about the preparedness of institutions. We talk about possibly a hybrid model or maybe some kind of other interventions as we go along for the autumn 21. But there's always a concern in this changing economic scenario around the world, and especially from a country like India, where we always look forward to opportunities where we either students secure some scholarship or some kind of an aid or a grant. Is there something which government of UK is mulling around where students are either offered or the university sector? I know you chair the African side of the UK. Yep. Any thoughts around that, where some kind of financial assistance, additional scholarships are being managed or granted to international students?
It's a really good point. And of course, as you know, the Chevening Scholarship Program is the UK's flagship, largely postgraduate program. We at Sussex, we're the fourth largest Chevening recipient in the UK. So it's something that we're particularly invested in as a university. And that comes in no small measure because the university's ranked number one and has been for 5 years in international developments. And it's a fantastic accolade for Sussex to have been that strong in that area for so long. But what it also means is that students interested in development studies, and there are is a substantial number coming from India and the South Asia region, along with Africa, as you rightly say, do apply for Chevening scholarships. We also see a large number of them coming into our science policy programs. Again, because Sussex has a particular cachet, world-class reputation in science policy, hot topic, as you know, energy policy, sustainability, those types of things. Every government everywhere in the world is tackling those issues from New Delhi to Jakarta to Buenos Aires and everywhere else in between. So we have a particular focus in, for us as a university, on Chevening. But there are, of course, the British Council's great scholarship schemes that are accessible. But what the UK universities are also offering is an expanded portfolio. It's always, institutions review annually their portfolio of scholarships. And for us, we're offering, again, a whole range of postgraduate scholarships, chancellor's master's awards, international and EU business and international EU and engineering scholarships that will enhance our offer. Now, almost all of these university awards range from £3,000 to £10,000. All of our self-funded students from India, postgraduate students, all of them who are paying themselves are eligible for our unlimited Sussex India scholarship, which is £3,000. Our Chancellor's Awards are £5,000. This makes a difference to a student's affordability, but it does not eliminate the cost entirely, of course not. So I think one of the priority issues for us as universities is ensuring that we get the scholarship offer right, but also that we can ensure that when the students do come, they are financially capable of sustaining themselves through the period that they're in the UK, but also making sure that our hardship funds are available for students who reach a hard time. And I know that the Times of India, which I read on a usually 2 to 3 times a week, I read the Times or the Hindustan Times, just to keep myself aware of activities in India. It's a country that I like a great deal. Indeed, Amit, and you'll no doubt be able to help me in due course. I'm learning Hindi on the side of other activities, so trying very gradually to begin that road as well. But the point being, actually, which is key, which is the Times and the Hindustan Times, they carried a lot of media coverage during last summer about Indian students suffering and struggling in the UK. We didn't have a serious number of students in that area. We were keen to support our students, not just with hardship loans, but with food packages that were delivered to their halls of residence and these types of things. Indeed, we work with the government of China on distributing food packages to their students, as an example. But the key core message here is going forward, the scholarships, the big flagship, the Chevenings equivalent, of course, those are highly prestigious, highly competitive awards that only a certain number of students will ever secure from anywhere in the world. We all know how competitive they are. What we need to do is make sure that our offer is competitive and our students can find a financially accessible entrance to UK higher education through our scholarship provision. And I hope, and I really hope, that we're in the position to offer Indian students that. But I do think it's important, Amit, from both of our sides as the university, but also as on behalf of IDP, that we make sure that the students who we are sending abroad are financially able to both not only afford the experience, but enjoy the experience of studying abroad, because we all know how very costly it is, but we want to make it accessible to as many people as possible.
No, I think you have said it right. But then, our challenge always has been, there's a small percentage of people who at times have experienced, because of some personal reasons, change in the economic conditions. And that's where we have come across, and students have raised these concerns around possible challenges and hardships. And that's why I think students do look forward to assistance or financial aid in form of scholarships. Now, the other thing which students have been asking, and I've got some questions around, of course, students are looking at exploring the opportunity of getting into UK, of course, experiencing the richness of culture and the education. But at the same time, they also look forward to an opportunity to work in UK because of availing the GIR and ensuring that they enrich themselves with some experience. In this current situation where, as you said, you are recovering at the moment, where the situation will be far more controlled as students get into UK by autumn 21, what kind of opportunities students look forward to in somewhat reopening of the economy and likely jobs around? What support institutions UAT Sussex Richard can offer or UK universities can offer to these international students to overcome these hard times and have really the experience which they are investing for?
Yeah, that's a really good question. And on a very simple level, every university will have a careers and employability service that will assist every single student, both when they're a student, but also when they're an alumni of the university, to secure employment. But at Sussex, we've done a few more pieces than that to try and help. So what we've been keen to develop is further placement opportunities for students on current programs. And we know that placement opportunities do open doors for future employment opportunities. We're keen to open up more graduate employment opportunities. And we've got a piece of work at the university on international graduate employability going forward. We want all of our graduates to be jobs ready, future ready graduates. So on one level, the answer to your question, Amit, is what we're delivering already inside the curricula, these jobs ready, futures ready graduates with the wayfinding skills, the kind of critical interdisciplinary skills that we know employers want. So that's the skill part. The employment offer is coming through directly from our careers services. But there's another part to the story, and you and I talk often about the geopolitics of India-UK relations and the like. What's the prospect of the UK's economic recovery? What's the prospect of quick economic recovery post-pandemic? Because at the moment, if we wandered into the city of Brighton, all the cafes are shut, the bars are shut, a lot of the kind of limited employment that students might pick up as part of their 20 hours a week when they can do is limited right now. It won't be in 6 weeks' time, but it is today. So, but that isn't the kind of employment that I want Amit IDP students to get. I want you to get jobs in meaningful careers as quickly as possible. If we listen to the economics, both the Bank of England and multiple economists predicting the economic recovery of the United Kingdom, they're looking at what they're referring to as a V-shaped recovery. And that's to say sharp downturn, quick upturn. The argument being very clearly that for about a, well, for over a year now, there has been absolutely suppressed spending. People are not spending money. There's nothing to spend it on, realistically. Shops are closed except online. So what they're expecting is that there will be a rapid economic recovery taking place at the end of 2021 and into 2022. So that by September 2022 and January 2023, at which point you on the telephone call on our Facebook Live today will be looking for a job in the UK. So if you're sitting there at the moment as an applicant, let's forward plan it to the moment that you've now got the degree from Sussex and you're into the GSR space. At that point, they're predicting fast recovery of economic growth, but a growth as well in employability. Now, in the city of Brighton and Hove, we happen to be very, very close to Gatwick Airport. We're an hour from London, but we have one of the largest small and medium-sized enterprise sectors in southern Britain. And it's exactly that growth area that has been, if you like, slowed like that during the pandemic that they're expecting to see grow like that after. I'm not an economist, but I am quoting the Bank of England and I am quoting government economists, not people who are optimistic because they've got a plan on tax return to the UK. So they're not being foolish in their predictions. So I think the long-term impact of this will be that COVID will have a very, very, very damaging impact in certain sectors of the economy. But I also believe that the long-term prognostics for the kinds of jobs that you all are interested in on the call is actually quite strong. So yes, it would have been stronger without COVID, that's pretty obvious, but the context of UK economic recovery are positive, but I think it's about the positive future. But to deliver on the positive future, you need the skills to make the best of the future. And I think that in that area, a lot of UK universities are doing a lot of very good work.
I'm sure. I think as students arrive with the kind of a changed world now into institutions. Now, one thing which comes to mind, and I think it's important to ask you, given that the vast experience you have matured into international education. You know the social scenario, you know the economic scenario. Would you like to comment which are top 3 to 5 areas for next 5 years for students to pick and choose from where they have comparatively, and I'm saying comparatively better prospects if they enroll into certain programs, not only in UK, but around the world. So which are those few areas you would like to advise students to possibly focus on as they look forward to study UK and some other parts of the world?
Very good question. And of course, as a professor of history, I'll always tell you history first. But joking aside, COVID has accelerated, and that's how I often describe it in webinars and like. It's COVID's an accelerator. It's shown the areas that are really important, and they've fast-tracked the significance of those areas. And I think they're really falling into three or four different areas. One is clearly around health and applied biomedical sciences. And that's going to range from being both training as physicians, pharmacists, medical therapeutics, et cetera, all the way down through nursing, all the way up through applied degrees such as physiotherapy and all those areas. So I think that whole space of health science, including virology, and of course India is superb in this respect, the Serum Institute, et cetera, but I think that the key message here is around health as number one. Obviously, the second area that is going to be growing is information technology. Within that, data science, artificial intelligence. I see great prospects for media practice in this space. What we have learned is that the world did not stop with COVID. We adapted quickly, and we use this type of platform to adapt the world to our continuing conversations. And so to me, I see a huge piece around the Internet of Things, artificial intelligence above all, robotics, data science itself. All of those areas will have been fast-tracked, not only by the changes that COVID has done, but also the reprioritization of data science and artificial intelligence in our lives. But I think that's the second area in that space around AI, data science, broadly construed, computer science within that, and related media platforms. So media practice and related degrees. And then, of course, I think we have to reinforce the point around business and management. And obviously, if you take the total number of students coming from India, almost 50% of Indian students who come to undergraduate and postgraduate degrees tend to come into the business and management area. And that remains pretty critical as we go forward. Moreover than that, we are going to be dealing with not just the former business model, but we're going to be adapting the business models that we take forward post-pandemic. But there is clearly a screaming need, an absolute screaming need from your generation, the young generation worldwide, for environmental sustainability. And we need to work as business leaders to be thinking about what and how do we deliver a green and sustainable business model going forward. So I think what we're going to be seeing is we talked a little bit about science policy and those areas, Amit, previously, but I see a continued demand, not just in terms of business and management, accountancy and the like, but I see an absolute need to align that business and management models with the needs of the future, including the sustainability agenda, the needs of a post-COVID business future. We need to ensure that our data science, artificial intelligence, computing and technology component is robust moving forward, and the health sciences area. So I've given you three, not five, but you could have picked out five in that very easily.
The broad areas, of course, these were the three areas, but I know there are hundreds of subjects within those areas, which I think students can benefit from your advice. Now, one quick question, because now we are on the verge of closing this conversation. Question coming is, of course, we spoke about the restrictions at the moment, the movement and everything. There are questions like, are students getting food easily, or is the public transport available to the students? So what's the current situation at the moment? I mean, these are
It is absolutely unchanged from what it was previously. Food supplies are absolutely 100% as they were previously. The only difference is that you wear a mask in the supermarket and you're asked to clean your hands with a hand gel. And that is it in terms of the practicalities. The bus service, the train service is running. We're expecting, interestingly, you should raise that. We're expecting an increase in the amount of UK domestic travel because we're coming out of lockdown. So the train company is increasing the number of services, the bus services, et cetera, et cetera. And I expect that to continue and not just as national travel eases up, but international travel eases as well.
Great. One quick question coming to me is on the self-isolation piece for the students. I know there was an advisory around the time that students are required to self-isolate and quarantine in a hotel. So is there a mechanism where either a student quarantines in a hotel or institutions are giving them halls of residences, which are private, somewhat private, and they can quarantine, and support is being offered to the student?
Yes, we're working with, at the moment, you only have to stay in a hotel. You do, if you go into Scotland, you have to go to a hotel wherever you've come from. Mm-hmm. But in England, the situation is that we have a red list of countries. So I would advise students, if they are thinking of traveling to the UK, keep an eye on the red list of countries. So even if you've gone through, for example, some of the Middle Eastern countries, some of the Gulf states, and you put down as a transfer from Mumbai to London, you become by default a red list. So do keep an eye on this in terms of practical travel. It's a long way until September, so things can change. At the moment, the UK sector is working with the government on international student arrivals. We are working with our halls of residence, and we are working with local providers should students need to quarantine. At the moment, if they're coming in from India, they would quarantine at home. They would not stay in an expensive hotel. If you, however, decide to buy a ticket which lands somewhere in the Gulf and onwards, then yes, that becomes a more challenging point in which you have to stay in a government hotel. Which I think is about £1,600, but we're working hard with the government to ensure that students who come in September, which is obviously the next big lift in numbers, will be able to come in as they did last September, quarantine, and we had students quarantining at the University of Sussex with food packages supplied by us, all of those things. And we hope to do that again.
Perfect. I think no doubts the students would really have got some great insights, not just on the basics, which they asked about the food and the travel, other aspects, but I think your insights on the government policy, the probable interesting areas in terms of subjects, you giving insight on a whole lot of other aspects to the students, they would really benefit and value from your experience and your insights. Thank you very much, Richard Follett, Deputy Pro Vice Chancellor and the Associate Vice President International at the University of Sussex, for this conversation with us at IDP. And we will continue engaging with you in due course to get more insights as we go for the autumn 21 intake. But until then, thanks a lot for your time and your insights. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Have a good day.